as the divine word and as divine purity, we have to believe that every scientific notion in the Quran is absolutely scientifically correct. It cannot be with any mistake. It cannot be with any violation with the many scientific facts discovered by man. The concordance of the Quran with the most recently developed scientific facts as a living testimony to the fact that this book cannot be the work of man. It's the divine word in its divine purity, and can also remain as a living testimony to the correct prophethood of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him. We mentioned in previous episodes a number of cosmic verses, and we have tried to understand them with the help of the scientific facts of our time, and we came to realize the high degree of precision by which these scientific notions are presented in the glorious Quran, although we have repeatedly admitted that these scientific notions did not come down to man as pieces of scientific information per se, because gaining science has been completely left for the human efforts generation after generation. Yet, we use these scientific notions to testify for the scientific precision of the Quran, which can be used to prove to the people of our time, this era of science and technology, that the Quran cannot be the work of man. It's the divine word in its divine purity. In this episode, we are discussing mountains in the glorious Quran. And I dare say that mountains have been mentioned in the Quran in 39 Quranic verses. I cannot cover these 39 Quranic verses, each of which is a living testimony to the scientific precision of the Quran. Yet, I will choose only one or two verses to prove to you that every scientific notion in the Quran is absolutely scientifically correct. The first of these verses comes from Surah An-Naba, chapter 78, the verse number 6-7. These two verses read, أَلَمْ نَجْعَلِ الْأَرْضَ مِهَادًا وَالْجِبَالَ أَوْتَادًا. Allah is testifying to unbelievers His might, knowledge, and wisdom by making the earth as a vast expanse, leveling the earth to become an accessible abode for man. And He said, أَلَمْ نَجْعَلِ الْأَرْضَ مِهَادًا. Didn't we make the earth for you a leveled expanse? And the science of geology has proved to us that the earth started with a very rugged topography. Then Allah, through His knowledge, wisdom, and might, has created wind, running water, gravity, plants, animals, to level this rugged topography, to change the high peaks of mountains into leveled plains. And by this, the earth became accessible to man. This took millions of years before the creation of man. And when man was created, he found the earth actually a very easily accessible expanse. And Allah is showing His might, knowledge, and wisdom in doing that, and is addressing unbelievers. Haven't you seen that we have made this earth, which has started with a highly rugged topography, highly complicated topography, we have made it an easily accessible, leveled expanse for you? And isn't this enough to testify to the fact that this universe needs a creator with the great wisdom and the great knowledge and the great power and will of a supreme being like the creator, who has created you and everything around you? And that's why the verse says, أَلَمْ نَجْعَلِ الْأَرْضَ مِهَادًا. Haven't we made the earth as a vast expanse, a leveled abode for you? وَالْجِبَالَ أَوْتَادًا. And haven't we made mountains as pegs or pickets? And I'm concentrating on the second verse. Haven't we made mountains as pegs or pickets? A peg is a wooden wedge that holds the sides of a tent firmly to the ground. And in as much as the wooden wedge is deeply buried in the ground, the greatest length of the wedge is buried in the ground, and only a small part of it is protruding above the ground surface. Recent geological discoveries have proved that mountains are exactly the same, like a peg or a picket. The greatest length of a mountain is deeply buried in the ground, and only a small part of it, 1/10 of that length to 1/15 of that length, is exposed above the ground surface. To simulate exactly the peg or the picket that's holding the sides of the tent firmly to the ground. And in as much as these pegs or pickets can hold the sides of a tent firmly to the ground, we came to realize that this is exactly the role of mountains on the surface of our planet. The one continent that was created by the Creator, by volcanic activity, the Mother Continent, or Pangaea, this was split into plates. The outer rocky layer of the Earth is split into a number of plates. Some of these plates constitute continents that are floating on a semi-molten layer called the zone of weakness, or the asthenosphere. And even the oceanic bottom is also broken into plates that are floating on top of a semi-molten layer called the asthenosphere. As the Earth rotates around its own axis, these plates actually glide away from each other or towards each other, like gliding on ice. And with this movement, especially at the beginning of the creation of the Earth, the movement was very fast. It would not allow any soil to accumulate, any plant to grow, any animal to exist, any house to be built, any road to be constructed, any civil device to be built. And that's why life on the surface of that planet was virtually impossible in the early stages of its creation. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created mountains. And the Quran, as well as the Hadith, emphasize the fact that mountains came at a later stage after the creation of the Earth. Mountains were created by these plates at the moments of colliding with each other. You see, at the axes of seas and oceans, these plates are drifting away from each other. So we can get an ocean bottom colliding with a continental mass. And as it collides with this continental mass, the sediments that have been accumulating on top of the ocean bottom would be scraped off and thrown on top of the overriding plate over the continent. And as the ocean bottom is gliding or sliding under a continental mass, it actually passes through much higher temperatures. And that's why it partially melts. And as a result of that melting, we get volcanicity. So volcanic eruption and lava flows would mix with the accumulating sediments. And as the plate moves further, it goes to the zone of weakness, the zone of semi-molten material. So it can displace some of the magma in the form of intrusions. And from that complex of sedimentary rocks, lava flows, and igneous intrusions, the mountainous chain is being created. And is created with the greatest length of it, deeply buried in the ground, and the shortest part of it being exposed above the surface. So once a mountain chain is created, it links the continental mass with the ocean bottom and brings this motion to a big halt. And that's how these mountains played a very important role in making our planet suitable for life. And that's why Allah is showing His bounty upon us, upon all beings actually, by creating mountains. without creating mountains, life on the surface of that planet would have been virtually impossible. And that's why Allah is showing His great bounties on man by addressing unbelievers, by telling them, أَلَمْ نَجْعَلِ الْأَرْضَ مِهَادًا وَالْجِبَالَ أَوْتَادًا. Haven't we made the earth as a vast expanse, a leveled expanse for your living? And haven't we made mountains as pegs, which can hold these vast expanses, these different plates together, to minimize their movement, so that you can easily live on the surface of that planet? And up until the 1990, the year 1990, all available acquired knowledge, all available textbooks, encyclopedias, sources of references, would describe mountains as surface protrusions, protrusions above the ground. They used to call them surface protrusions above the ground. Nobody knew anything about the fact that these mountains are actually deeply buried in the ground. Although, since the early days of the 20th century, there were whispering about the possibility of these mountains having roots. Yet, this was not proved until the last few decades of the 20th century, when we came to realize that mountains are deeply buried in the ground, and the so-called mountain roots are actually 10 to 15 times the length of the mountains' elevations above sea level. For the Quran, a book revealed more than 14 centuries ago to an unlettered prophet, sallallahu alayhi wasallam, peace be upon him, in an unlettered society, to spell this fact out, although in a metaphoric way, to explain this, that precisely by saying, أَلَمْ نَجْعَلِ الْأَرْضَ مِهَادًا وَالْجِبَالَ أَوْتَادًا. Haven't we made the earth as a wide, vast expanse to be an easy abode for living, and have made mountains as pegs or pickets? To spell that out is a scientific precedence that can testify to the fact that the glorious Quran cannot be the work of man. It's the word of the Creator in its divine purity, and can testify to the correct prophethood of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, who was sent for the guidance of man more than 14 centuries ago, who was sent to an unlettered society which had no knowledge of science, and nobody at his time, anywhere in the world, could have perceived this fact at all, which was only disclosed to the human knowledge in the later decades of the 20th century. Haven't we made the earth as a vast expanse, an easy, accessible abode for living, and haven't we made mountains as pegs or pickets? This is one of the greatest scientific notions in the glorious Quran that can easily testify to every rational person that this noble book cannot be the work of man. It's the word of the Creator in its divine purity, and it's the word that was carried out to the seal of prophethood, Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, who communicated it to his scribes and was committed to writing more than 14 centuries ago. The simple notion that mountains are pegs or pickets is really one of the great scientific notions in the Quran, because as I said, up until 1990, every definition of mountains was no more than surface protrusions. I wrote a booklet on mountains in the Quran that was published in Washington, D.C. in 1992, and I collected all the definitions of mountains in geologic books, geologic dictionaries, encyclopedias, all available information in many languages, the Arabic, the English, the French, the German, the Latin. All these references up until 1990 would define mountains as surface protrusions above sea level. For the Quran to emphasize the deeply buried nature of mountains is a living testimony to the scientific precision of the glorious Quran, the correctness of every scientific notion that came within its verses, and a living testimony to the fact that this book cannot be the work of man. I have other verses that speak about mountains in the glorious Quran. I will choose one or two because I cannot cover all the 39 verses that speak about mountains. And I found in Surah An-Nahl, chapter number 16, Surah number 16, verse number 15, we find a notion about mountains that is also scientifically unique. The Quran reads, وَأَلْقَى فِي الْأَرْضِ رَوَاسِيَ أَنْ تَمِيدَ بِكُمْ. Allah has thrown down into the earth stabilizers lest it should shake with you. And see the beauty of the Quranic expression, وَأَلْقَى فِي الْأَرْضِ رَوَاسِيَ أَنْ تَمِيدَ بِكُمْ. And Allah has thrown into the earth stabilizers lest it should shake with you. And nowadays we know that the breakage of the continental masses and the oceanic floor into a large number of plates that are drifting either away from each other to create oceanic bottoms or colliding with each other to create mountain chains, we can see that the movement of these plates was in the past much faster than the rates of movements of today. And this rate has been minimized by the creation of mountains, which act as stabilizers for the continental masses on top of which we can live. So the Quran is showing the bounties of Allah upon us by creating mountains. وَأَلْقَى فِي الْأَرْضَ رَوَاسِيَ أَنْ تَمِيدَ بِكُمْ وَأَنْهَارًا وَسُبُلًا لَعَلَّكُمْ تَهْتَدُونَ. And Allah has thrown into the earth stabilizers lest it should shake with you, and rivers and ways would make you easily guided on earth, because you see, through the flowage of a river, these rocks can be cut into river plains, and we can have river banks that are easily level for people to move in, for animals as well. So Allah is showing his bounties upon us by stabilizing the continental masses of mountains, and by using these continental masses as a means of dropping rain, and by the rain to run down on the surface of the globe to cut down channels and level the ground and make deltas and make plains so that the earth would be easily accessible to man. These cosmic verses are actually one of the living testimonies that can prove to every rational person the scientific precision of the Quran, and can testify to the fact that this noble book cannot be the work of man. It is the word of the Creator in its divine purity, and it also testifies to the fact that Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, was not speaking out of his own memory, out of his own mind, but he was receiving this guidance from the Creator through Archangel Gabriel, may Allah be pleased with him, and he communicated this to his scribes, and it was committed to writing immediately after this the revelation of the Quran. So such notions are only a small part of what we could see from the 39 Quranic verses that speak about the Quran, and discussing them in the light of the scientific facts of the time can be used as a means of da'wah to people of our time who can always seek the scientific evidence for any question they are asked, and these scientific notions can be the proper answer to the people of our time. And for another episode, I leave you with the blessings of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and his peace, and greeting you in our Islamic way. Assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. May Allah's peace and blessings be with you all.